Good afternoon and welcome to the very hot sunset safari here on Djuma and Arethusa private game reserves. My name is Scott and it's great to be back behind the wheel. The last few days, I'm sure a lot of you are aware, we've been doing two Nat Geo TV broadcasts wherein I was involved on bushwalks and it was great fun. Brent's turn was today, I was yesterday, and I was actually out trekking this morning at the very early stage of 3:30 a.m. Myself, Bright and Jeffrey headed out in the hope that we would find Shadow, the female leopard that we did in fact finding after she had just made an impala kill. The last thing I saw was the impala kicking. I didn't actually see her too clearly, but it was kind of simultaneous as I saw her. Peter, who we had called into the area, also stumbled across her, and then our job as trackers was done and he took over and enjoyed a wonderful sighting with her, and we are heading back into the area where she was last seen. And I'll tell you a little bit more about exactly what happened as we go along. Now, before she could even have one mouthful of that impala that she killed, I'm told Peter, who's already left us along with Hayden and Graham, that have straight after the morning drive, she killed the impala, and within a few seconds two hyena came racing in and stole it from her, started feeding on it. She came back, tried to steal a few scraps, and they chased off again. She ended up getting a tiny bit of meat to feed on and was left lying in a riverbed not far from where she made the kill. So we're gonna head back there and hopefully we're gonna find her. I'm just gonna ask Vim to please put his headphones on because the audio from FC is coming through his little earpiece. He's got two different comms channels coming through, one from the ambience audio coming from the cameras and the other one coming from his earphones. No difference to me. I've also got two inputs of audio coming through, although one is not from the audio of the cameras, it's from the game drive channel. I can hear Taxon giving a few updates. It sounds like he's searching for lions up in Buffalo's Hook, the property to the north of us. And there's another game drive who's also out, and you'll be spending a lot of time with them this afternoon, and that's Jamie and Jandre, and they've already found an animal that they would like to share with you. So we're getting off to a good start and we'll catch up a little bit later.
Good afternoon everyone and welcome to the Sunset Safari, and myself along with Scott are back again once on the back of the vehicles with you all. And what a better way to start the afternoon but with this amazing elephant herd just chilling out at the Djuma waterhole. And they're looking perfectly relaxed. There was some interesting, just before we went live, there was some interesting interaction with a couple of buffalo who came to join in the fun on this very hot and somewhat humid Sabi Sands afternoon. I almost feel like there's going to be a storm. It hasn't hit yet. But what a wonderful few days we have had, and what a wonderful way to start the afternoon. There's elephants shouting in the background. Now watch how they are focused around that particular point and have a look at that. And the reason is because this particular waterhole is pumped. So although there's an entire open space for them to drink, they're all crowded around that particular point. And that's because ellies, just like us, know where the fresh water is coming from, and that's what they prefer. And that's why they're all around that particular area. So that's where the water comes out to this particular water hole. They still know how to share though. Just think, one trunk full of that, that's about 12 liters of water. So imagine downing or drinking 12 liters of water in one gulp. That's exactly what she's doing. space around that particular water point. And although it can be really difficult to hear over the wind blowing, I can hear them breathing and trying to breathe out before they take a big trunk full of water, which I can sympathize with, having choked many times myself trying to breathe and drink at the same time. Look at all those trunks crowding for a bit of space. Here we go. An absolutely amazing way to start the afternoon. Two or three big females and their calves, all sharing the water. And I feel like the one on the right with her two have definitely won the battle of the freshest water here. And if we look across to the left, although he might actually be giving me a bit of a hairy eyeball, but if we just look at that buffalo over there, I feel like he's been quite seriously displaced from where he wants to be right now. So a big male buffalo, part of a couple of Dugger boys, as they're known. So the male buffalo hanging around this area that they came down for a wallow in the hot afternoon sun and got somewhat displaced by the Ellie herd. So they've all found spots in the shade to just hang out and spend some time. And this is, October is such a typical month. So out here in the Sabi Sands and most of Limpopo in South Africa, which is where we are at the moment, this time of year, typically, which is exactly the pattern that this year is following, it's hot, it's dry, it's windy, you can hear it coming through. It's just an interesting time of year. It's right at that transition, just before the big rains hit. And of course, we're all holding thumbs that the big rains are going to come, because it puts animals like buffalo and elephant under pressure right now, just because there's so little water, or so little natural water available to them. But you get these dry winds, really, really hot conditions. It's perfect for the spread of the fires that are naturally occurring out here, but also just a time of year where water holes, such as the Djuma water hole that we're sitting at right now, completely disappear and turn from mud wallows in maybe 7 days to completely dry and cracked mud. Just have a look at the Ellies. This is always an interesting time. You can see the rest of the herd are still on the outskirts. And at the moment, just driving past the original Djuma waterhole, you hit with the smell of catfish that are slowly dying in the mud. It's a time of year where we really, really need rain. These Ellies are still so focused on the water source that they have. The female off to the left is, she's kind of, not quite, but she's kind of been pushed off to the side a little bit. She doesn't have access at the same level to the fresh water, so she's at the sort of the pan that is pumped and develops. She's been wandering around in there. Now, as I touched upon earlier, it has been a really, really interesting time and quite a hectic week for all of the Wild Earth staff. But that being said, Donna would like to know if we're back to the normal drive times. And yes, Donna, absolutely we are. Just for this afternoon, we are only doing a 2-hour drive, which makes it 4 to 6 South African time. Please don't ask me to convert, because that's an absolute struggle at any point in my life. But from 4 to 6 South African time, so from our starting point, 2 hours. But from tomorrow, it will be completely back to normal. And then we'll see how daylight goes and when the sun is rising and the sun is setting. With temperatures as hot as they are, I'm sure that we're going to be going backwards sort of half an hour or so, just because it is so hot. But we do really, really appreciate all of your support in the times that we have had to shift drive times around, and we've had to reserve certain times for all of the stuff that we had to put together. And we do really appreciate from our most loyal viewers who've been with us as long as they have. Thank you very much. We really, really appreciate it. I'm sorry, I'm just looking at the littlest calf in this mess of elephants, and he's kind of trying to stuff his head in between mom and the older calf to get his trunk in there. Has to kind of tuck his or her, I can't quite see from this angle, but tuck his head under there to get access to that water. And just to think, we've been sitting here for at least the last 5 minutes, if not longer. They are thirsty, thirsty animals. Look at that. You can see how she's manipulating the water source. And that's the part of water that they love. And it's really not unheard of, or at least not, I've experienced it many times in my career out in the bush, where an elephant comes along and digs up the pipelines that you've just laid just to get at some water that they seem to enjoy far more than the water that they actually have access to. And Chandra and I are seated nicely downwind of the catfish dam, and we're certainly getting a whiff of the catfish that didn't make it into the summer heat. Most of them have dug their way into the mud, but the rest of them are dead and decaying within the cracked mud. Doesn't seem to bother these ellies too much though. And if I'm quiet for a moment, I'm not sure, it's so windy at the moment, but I'm going to try and be quiet so that you can hear the sounds of them slurping and drinking, if I can use that word. It sounds like when you have a straw right at the bottom of your drink, when you finish the last bits of your drink, and you're just sucking up the last few moments, that's what it sounds like. Watching as she's the largest female in this particular group is drinking away, and Trisha, who's watching all the way from Toronto, thank you. It is wonderful to be back in Wendy and to be driving you guys all around. And you were wondering if she'd be kind enough to share with the other Ellies that are around her, and at the moment she's definitely quite happy to share with the two youngsters. Just looking at their sizes, I would say They... No, I think only one of them would actually be her calf. The other one is obviously because of the relationship of the herd, is related to her, but not necessarily her offspring. And she's quite happy to share with them because they're somewhere under about 6 years old. But you'll notice that the other females, or at least the other female and her calf or her offspring, are standing off to the side. It's not that the female won't share, it's just that she's taking first advantage for her and her calf and the other individual that's with her. But she will be happy to share at some point. I think she's probably had to push her way in for now. And it's worth remembering that although elephant herds are so closely bonded, they still have moments where it's most important to look after yourself and to look after the youngest members of the herd, those of them who aren't the most resilient. And then after that, you can be a little bit more sharing, a little bit more friendly towards the rest of the herd. So yes, absolutely she would, but it would take a little while. Jandre and I just got a fresh whiff of catfish blowing across us. So talking about that fresh whiff of catfish that we're experiencing, and over the last few days, I know that many of you watching the Djuma cam, and a couple of days ago, I think it was James had the hyena over here with the catfish kill. Auntie Lynn, you were wondering why it is that the vultures haven't appeared. Is it because they don't like fish, or what is the reason? Because there's so many dead catfish that were lying in that muddy area. Honestly, I think it's in terms of how they see prey. You very seldom get vultures hanging around something any smaller than a steenbok, and even then you might get one or two that happen to get lucky to see it in the bush. It's only when you get big kills such as buffalo, and yes, vultures have amazing eyesight, but they're not typically geared towards hunting or at least scavenging on things like dead catfish. It's a bit small, it's a bit out of their comfort zone, and they're competing with too many other animals out here. What you seeing, Jandre? Aha! It's actually not often I've seen warthogs brave enough to come down here at this time of day. Where did you go hide? Is he ducked away? Oh, there he goes. Or she, I can't tell from this distance. A fantastic place to be in terms of animal viewing at this particular time of year, obviously because we have the pumped water holes. That's why we get the illies coming, really taking advantage of the water sources that we have. But George, who is all the way in Florida, and I wonder, George, if it ever gets as hot as it does here, which it certainly feels like it's baking warm. Another warthog, or same warthog, sorry. Oh, got a fright. You can just see its ears poking up over the top of the buffalo on the left, trying to gather up the courage to come and drink at the waterhole. And George, I know that was part of your question, so I'll get back to that in a moment. Just want to see if this warthog is brave enough to come and join us. Thinking about it, very caught, nope, not happening. A very cautious approach from that particular warthog at this waterhole, and it is one of the only water sources that we have left, apart from Biffleshook Dam, which is a naturally occurring dam. And George, you were wondering how many dams that we have that are pumped within the area that we drive on. Now, as far as I know, it's only this particular dam and the Arethusa Dam that will be artificially maintained. The Arethusa Dam is much, much bigger, and it seems to hold water in a way, so I'm not too sure if it's being pumped at the moment. But as far as I know, this and Arethusa's dams are the only two within our traverse area, so the only two within the area that we drive around. I'm just watching because here is the perfect place to be. We've got elephants, we've got buffalo, and behind us, really kind of getting their nerve up, and I'm not going to ask Jandre to have to turn all the way around, they're right behind the car. But we've also got that herd of wildebeest that have been hanging around quarantine. And they're just giving me that look, like they're not quite sure, they really want to be here, but they're not quite sure if they want to challenge the elephants. I'm going to see if I can shift backwards slightly. The last few days I've forgotten how to work an immobilizer. And it's not me that they're looking at. So if we watch their body language, they're coming, they want to come down and drink, and it's the same as the warthog that we saw earlier. But elephants are renowned for being quite defensive over their water holes. So they're really thirsty and they want to come down, but there's an entire elephant herd, or at least five elephants in front of them, getting in their way. This sub-adult is being fairly brave. Let's see how successful she is. Oh, stop to smell some elephant dung, as you do. Okay, let's see. Oh, there we go. That's the reaction. Shame. Oh, she tried. She tried really hard, but that female who has been hogging the water source just had to raise her head and take two steps forward. And the body language in animal world was clear enough to say, no, you're not coming to share just yet. We're not done drinking. Oh, we have another attempt. Let's see how that goes. Getting watched. Being watched. Shame. She's so thirsty. She really wants to try. She's gonna go. Watch the female on the right. Trying to get close. There you go. Let's see if she manages this time. You can see the calf. Oh, there we go. Another one's been brave enough to join her. Well done, wildebeest. You made it. To the opposite side of the drinking hole. Let's just watch this female elephant's reaction, because the rest of the herd is coming down now. And she's seriously unimpressed with it. She's got her head up in the air. Oh! This is up. Quite thoroughly disapproving, but she's going to have to learn to share. This is the only water that's left in this vicinity. Here comes another one. Dashing across. try and sneak a drink from the opposite side of the waterhole. And you wouldn't think of elephants as animals that the other sort of prey or herbivores would have to avoid. But you have to remember that they look after their own first and foremost. There goes another one. Little soft contact call. Not quite old enough to want to be separate from at least the herd, if not more. And believe it or not, those calves we were looking at would only have been born last year, December. That's how fast they grow. The other thing that has to be factored in at the moment is the fact that it is so windy. And it makes every animal out here a little bit nervous, especially elephants, but also animals like wildebeest that are a constant source of prey. Got an adult an adult female feeding here. I'm going to tell you a little bit about adults versus sub-adults in a moment, but Chandra, if we can we can go that way. She's very cross. So I spoke a little about elephants not wanting to share. And they're chasing them all around. Look how cross she is. I think the tree might be a little bit in the way of the female on the right. I'm gonna slide forward a little bit. She's relaxing a bit. But she got so cross with the wildebeest on my right that she ran off and chased them. Even though there's plenty of water, there's plenty of space to share. Still see that head up? Ears out, looking down her nose almost. A very clear indication. Are you done now? Are you gonna stop chasing them away? Her calf is picking up her mood as well. Can see. Also, mimicking mommy's posture. Ears out, looking down nose. Feeling brave and big, and that's also because the rest of the wildebeest are approaching or trying to once again. And it's such a drama that plays out at the waterhole. As we watch the situation play out, we've got a buffalo who's come down to come and drink here, complete with oxpeckers who are quite happy to share and sit on the back of the same buffalo. No problem there. Isabella, who's 4 years old, would like to know why the elephants don't want to share in this particular instance. And Isabella, I think it's because, it's hard to explain, but I think it's mainly because they've got to look after each other. And that's the first place that they, that's the first thing they try and do. You can see they're quite happy to share with the buffalo, strangely enough. But I think because they're stressed and thirsty, they just want to make sure that their babies get their first drink. It is so important. It's not the way that we do things as humans. Obviously, we want to share first. But for these elephants, because they don't always get a drink, it's important that their mothers and their aunties look after them first. Little bit of conflict happening there with sub-adult wildebeests. They've all shifted behind the tree, as they do. But back to Isabella's point about not sharing, Diana, you were wondering why it is that a female might kick away a baby that is trying to suckle. And the answer is mainly, most of the time it's a female that's not lactating, so not producing milk, but sometimes it is a female that's producing milk and they just push them away because it's not their offspring. So it's not their calf that's trying to feed, and they just try to push them away so that their calf has an opportunity to feed. It's essentially just they look after their own babies before they look after other babies, even if they do look after the rest of the babies in the herd. And it's a difficult one because elephant herds are so closely bonded. I'm just going to duck my head so we can have a look at these lot. That female on the left, who didn't have her chance to drink, has now finally moved in. And she's making the most of it. This is how water pipes get broken. Stop it, little one. You're gonna smash that water pipe. Enjoy it from there. You don't need to dig it up anymore. Still all focusing around that particular point where the water comes out. Some rumbling between them. And I mentioned before that they might be a little bit unsettled just because of how windy it has been. And Charlene, you were wondering if it is as windy as it sounds, because it doesn't necessarily look so windy. The answer is it's coming and going at the moment, which has been the standard pattern, having been one of the people, or at least the person navigating the drone driver around over the last few afternoons. It has been gusting at this time of the afternoon. So yes, it is as windy at times. It comes and goes. It's a very hot, dry wind. I've described it before as opening up an oven when you're cooking. And that's kind of what it feels like. Or possibly leaving a hairdryer on the hottest setting and blowing it at your face. That's roughly what the wind feels like at the moment. Females made her way, the original female at least, and her two have made their way back in. We spoke a little bit about females pushing calves away, at least female elephants pushing calves away. And just to carry on that particular topic of conversation, Jennifer, you would like to know if a baby's mother is pushing it away. So if she's not lactating and she pushes the baby away, oh, what's going to happen here? Hold on. Wildebeest is not that brave. Thought about it, is thirsty enough to think about it, but still not worth tangling with something that is roughly 4 or 5 tons in weight when you're only 200 kilograms or 450 pounds. It's not really worth it. Sorry, Jennifer, we'll get back to your question in a moment. So they seem to have quietened down a little bit. And Jennifer, you were wondering what happens if the mother rejects the calf or isn't producing milk and she pushes the calf away. What will happen to the calf? It's a difficult one. It might be that the calf's actions eventually stimulate her to produce milk. But in the case where she doesn't and it doesn't work, and it's very, very rare that actually happens, but if it does happen that way, then the calf will probably die. it's not often that you get elephant cows that are, that will feed another calf over their own. So that other calf would really have to compete with that particular offspring. It doesn't often happen. And most likely that calf will die. But it has been recorded to happen, and elephants do occasionally allosuckle offspring that aren't their own, because they are so tightly bonded. And it's interesting if we compare them to, say, lions, where the one pride member will suckle, so she will feed cubs that are not her own. But they tend to time it very closely to each other. So lions will often have cubs within maybe a couple of weeks or so of each other. You're still watching the wildebeest. Shame, man, let them drink. That's all they're trying to do. Still with that head up, ears out, slightly threatening posture. Not terribly impressed by the whole deal. And you have to feel for them. And we're going to be seeing this behavior more and more as this weather continues and as the dry season continues. The pressure for water is going to become all the more intense. And just while we're sitting here, I'm trying to look for it, but it's straight into the sun. But you would have heard a constant bird call while we've been here for the last half an hour or so, or 35 minutes. I can sort of hear it. But Susie, you were wondering what the bird call is. It's a starling, and it is a birchall starling, and I'm trying to look for it for you, but I can't quite see it at the moment. But that's the sound. That was a terrible impersonation, I'm sorry. But that's the sound that you're hearing. It's been an almost constant presence while we've been sitting here. And you see them very commonly around camp. And I'm sorry to detract from Susie's question, but let's just have a look at this particular young elephant. There he goes. Here he goes. Chasing the poor wildebeest. All they're trying to do is drink. And they're terribly unimpressed with the situation. Aha! But two of them have been clever and snuck up around the back. Oh, three of them, four of them. They're trying to sneak around the back of the elephant. She hasn't noticed, and neither has the young one. So hopefully they get another chance to drink. She's chasing wildebeest again. There's dust flying everywhere. It's interesting. They're not chasing them away from water. They're just being grumpy. That is all they're doing. It's got nothing to do with resources. It's got everything to do with them invading their personal space. Look at how offended they look. Head in the air, tail up. So indignant. There is nothing like an elephant to embody indignation. They are so cross. They're not quite sure why they're cross, but they're so cross. As we watch the poor wildebeest herd finally make their way to the dam and finally get their afternoon drink. I believe that this is Sylvie V's first time in a while viewing, and she's absolutely loving it. So welcome back, Sylvie. It is fantastic to have you. And as we stomping away in the water, isn't this a special sighting to get to share with you? elephants being a little bit unfair, and I love elephants, but they are being a little bit unfair. But finally, the wildebeest, their patience has paid off. They finally had their chance to. I'm actually quite surprised by that. I thought that they would stick around for a bit longer. A couple of them are very, very thirsty. Short-lived drinks overnight. I have yet to see a crocodile in this particular pan. It wouldn't be a... Oh, hello, where did you come from? Are you also waiting your turn? Little warthog has obviously been spending some time in the overflow, covered in mud. Oh, gone. Also feeling a little bit shy. Much like the crocodiles have been in my time here. I've never seen a crocodile yet. But they do come and go, and they tend to favour the bigger dams because that's where the most access to resources is, but you just never know, which is why I would never advise swimming in a dam within Africa, especially if you can't see, you just don't know what's around. And speaking of not knowing what's around, I believe that Scott has found you something maybe somewhat unexpected. So let's head across to him, and I'm going to see what else I can find and catch up with you a little bit later.
Welcome back, everyone. And we've just decided to reposition the vehicle. Quite a beautiful animal. Just give us a moment or two, please. What it is just yet. Beautiful spots or rosettes, and as he zooms in, you'll notice we have been lucky enough to find Shadow, this female leopard. Sadly, my parking wasn't the best, so you can't see her face, but we will reposition. Also slightly be able to get you a view of her. She's full of both dika that she was feeding on late last night, which is a small antelope, and we returned to the site where she had that dika kill at about 3:30 this morning, and she wasn't there, so we decided to head towards the closest water, which was the Arethusa waterhole, in the hope that we would find some of her tracks. And it didn't take us long to indeed find her tracks and start following her footprints, which led us to very close to where we heard her make a kill of an impala this morning. It was very interesting to hear. It's not something you get to hear very often, but once an impala has been caught from the herd, the alarm calls will be very different to that of when they simply see a leopard. I'm just going to try and creep forward a tiny bit forward. We are on the edge of a small cliff here, so just been delaying it somewhat. That should be enough. There we go. As I was saying though, she was successful in catching an impala, and the whole herd started shouting wildly at her. I was probably 100 meters away when I heard the impala, and I was on the phone to the girls in the final control room telling them to get Peter into that area as quick as possible. And him and VM were thankfully in that area anyway, and we stumbled upon her at the same time. As I said earlier, it wasn't long before the hyena caught wind of this opportunity to steal her food, which they did. But she did get a few scraps, and her belly's quite full, not nearly as full as it would be, and it would have taken her about 3 days to finish an adult impala had she have been able to feed on it in peace. But for now, she's just relaxing in this cool sandy riverbed. And I hope it won't be too long before she thinks of going to have a drink at Arethusa Waterhole, which is only about half a mile away from us here. Very close to the Arethusa camp and waterhole, probably only about where her tracks had generally been moving in the whole morning. Just going to try and get a hold of the Arethusa guides again. I tried to call them to let them know we found her, but I don't think anybody heard me, so just give me a moment please. Can any station copy me? I've located Shadow off Magic Willy, just probably 200 or 300 meters east of that pump house. Last station, I'm not copying you clearly, but you're more than welcome to make your way. It's just myself here, and if you also don't mind just controlling the sighting, the standbys. Okay, so I just let the guys know what's going on, and the first person to hear me, I couldn't hear who it was exactly, is going to come and join us, and I'm sure a lot more will continue to join. Excuse me, as the afternoon unfolds. Oh, a little fly is giving her a bit of frustrations. You can see how she's panting quite heavily. Unlike us, they cannot sweat, so just like dogs, they will pant to keep cool. And it's an extremely hot afternoon. Thankfully, there's a bit of a breeze kicking up now. And thanks so much to all the welcome back messages that have been sent through. A lot of the regular Safari Live presenters have been behind the scenes a little bit over the last week or so, as Hayden and Peter have been in town, and happy to hear that you're enjoying having your regular safari guides back in the saddle. It's great to be back here with you, and it's the last time I will be taking a drive until I return on the 2nd of November. So, quite relieved I'm getting one more safari with all of you guys. I thought my last one was about a week ago. So this is a pleasant surprise. I'm also very happy to be spending it with this female leopard, who really did put on a remarkable show for us this morning. If it wasn't for her, we wouldn't have had nearly as much action as we did for that very important TV broadcast. And it's not to say that we don't take every drive seriously, but there were a lot of people watching that, so very happy that we managed to give them a great Safari Live experience, and hopefully a lot of them are tuned in on the internet this afternoon. And as I've said in the past, the more people that join on in these safaris will simply mean the more places we get to travel through Africa and hopefully the world. And that's a dream that I hope comes true one day. Oh, hello to Donna, who's just sent through a message on Twitter. And she would like to know if Tingana's around. Now, Tingana is a big dominant male leopard whose territory encompasses this female's as well as this female's mother, called Karula. And actually, Tingana was last seen mating with Karula. And we are not too sure where either of them are. The fact that there was a mating pair of leopard on the Djuma Waterhole camera late last night suggests that it could well be them. Interesting, because they would have moved a large distance from where they were last seen on the western side of Arethusa, but anything's possible. And their tracks enter Djuma from our southern boundary, actually, when we were returning back to camp this morning. We found tracks of two leopards that were seen mating on the Djuma waterhole camp. Sadly, nobody had any luck finding where they headed from after the waterhole, but it could well be Tsingana and Krula still mating back on Djuma, so hopefully Jamie will get lucky and possibly bump into them later or hear the audio of them mating. But I'm not too sure exactly where they are. We haven't had any confirmed reports, and it's dangerous business to just assume which leopard is which, just judging from the tracks on the ground.
Oh, wonderful. Listen to that call.
It's called a rainbird or a Birchall's kukau. Oh, it's right there. Well spotted, Vian. Oh, the sun's right in my eyes. Can you believe it? Maybe we'll get to actually see it call again. I think we will. Come on, call again for us. What perfect sunlight as well. I think we'll have one more crack at it. VM's fast at work and got you another great view of this bird. They're usually quite secretive. You often don't see too much of them. They're predators and often feed on small chicks that they pluck out of their nests, as well as insects, small rodents. I've got a beautiful call. Yes, there it goes again. Awesome. Well, you can't see it too clearly, but it is up there. And to be able to see a bird is... Oh no, there's another one calling. There's two of them calling around us. I can't see where the second one is. Maybe it's two lovers trying to serenade one another. Let's see if the other one doesn't call back now. And possibly another bird for you to add to your bird lists. And if you haven't started your bird lists yet, what a better time than now. And it's a great way for you to be able to... Oh, I think VM spotted the other one. He's swiveling around with purpose. Oh, there we go. Well done, VM. Well, hopefully they will continue to call, and then you should be able to see it very clearly. So clearly that's the other one calling now. You'll see its throat enlarge quite greatly when it does let off its call. Come on. Oh. No luck. But trust me, that was luckier than we've been on a lot of times with the birds. They often fly off before we even get a glimpse of them, let alone get to show you them calling and hear them calling and get such great views of them. We haven't forgotten about you yet, Shadow. Don't worry. Oh, sorry, Shadow. I was just having a sip of my water and she didn't like the sound of it, or maybe she was jealous, who knows. It is very hot. And look at how beautiful she is. Look at those eyes and those long white whiskers. Awesome stuff. So there have been some rumors that are traveling through various media platforms that this leopard's cub will be returning from its rabies vaccinations, where it's been safe housed for the last couple of weeks to make sure it can be returned hopefully safely to this area. And Anna Marie, I'm not entirely sure. We haven't heard any updates, and until we hear any updates, we will not believe anything that's said on any of the various social media platforms. It doesn't matter who says they've spoken to who. We are waiting to hear from the relevant people who will keep us updated. So don't worry, we're not hiding anything from you, and be sure to know that as soon as we hear any updates of the return of this leopard's cub, we will be sure to tell you. So it's probably not worth getting your hopes up until we do. I know a lot of you miss him dearly, as do we, and hope that he does return. But at this stage, we are still just having positive thoughts for that to happen, but have yet to get any confirmation thereof. I think she's going to get up fairly soon, and we're going to get to see her moving through this riverbed. And after about 15 or 20 minutes, she should end up at the Arethusa waterhole, where she's going to quench her thirst. Just judging by the way she's getting a bit fidgety, I don't think it's going to be too much longer that we have to wait. Deanna in Michigan is also interested to know what we think will happen when they do come to releasing Sandile, if that is the case in the future, which we hope it is, and whether or not it'll be close to where she is. It's a very good question, Deanna. I've never seen or been involved in a scenario like this, so I've got very little knowledge on the matter. I'm guessing they will naturally try and get him as close to her as possible, but whether or not that is critical or a concern for the vets and professionals involved, I actually don't know. It's such a bizarre scenario that's unfolded, and one that doesn't happen very often, so I'm gonna keep my opinions and thoughts as to what is going to happen out of this, because I've got no substantial past encounters or stories of this nature to go by. So it would be a very unwise and unexplainable kind of thought process. So I'm going to rather wait and see what happens. Hello, Mary in Michigan, and good to have you with us. Mary in Michigan would like to know, which was the bird that we've just seen and heard calling? So I'm going to get the book out. It's called the Birchall's Cook Owl, Kukul, not a cuckoo. I know our pronunciation can sometimes be a little bit misleading, so it's not the regular cuckoo, but a cook owl, which I'll show you the spelling of shortly. My alphabet temporarily left me there, so I was struggling in the index. It's been a long, hard week for a lot of us, and I'm certainly looking forward to going and relaxing tomorrow. So this is at the Birchall's Kukul. And there you can see it's spelled Kukal, not Cuckoo, C-U-C-K-O-O. And Mary, I'm not happy to hear that you will miss me, but I am touched by that kind remark, and it won't be long before I'm back recharged and rejuvenated and looking forward to taking you all on a lot more safaris. So don't worry, I'll be back after a much needed break. As much as we all love working out here, the cameramen, the presenters, the directors, 6 weeks in a very small place doing the same thing day in and day out can begin to start playing with your mind. And that's one of the things that you learn when working out in the bush. Towards the end of any 6 week cycle, after 7 days a week of work, you start to look forward to your 2 week break. So it's a much needed thing. And now we've actually been here for 8 weeks this time around because of the Nat Geo broadcast. So it was a 2 week longer than normal stint, and I can't wait to head home and see my friends and family. Let's see if you think the shadow is looking any more promising for some movement. It's not looking great. She stopped fidgeting around, still panting very deeply. Oh, well, great news from Mike in Florida. And he's just managed to get to his 101st bird on his list, thanks to the Birchall's Kukul. So very, very well done. I can hear a barred owl calling behind us now, I think. Not its regular call. And it might be worth going and having a look for a little bit later on. Some Cape turtle doves calling nearby. Kru-kru-ru. Kru-kru-ru. Now, rumor has it that there is some rain potentially forecasted tomorrow, which will be great for this area. Don't be fooled by the bright green that you can see. It's abnormally dry at the moment. The water holes are not nearly as full as they should be at this time of the year. You can see a few faint and wispy clouds. Certainly doesn't look like anything too serious or that we should be concerned about for rain this evening, but I'm told that the weatherman does think that we are going to get some moisture, which will be absolutely wonderful. Possibly not for the safari that would be scheduled during that period, as we're not very well kitted out for rain, but it will be wonderful for the animals that live here. Having said that though, possibly not for the predators. You know, the tougher it is for the prey animals, the herbivores, the easier life becomes for the predators. So you'd probably find that Shadow wouldn't mind if there was a drought condition, because there'd be lots of easy prey to pick off. But because she's such a good hunter, she caught a dike yesterday and one today, she's probably not too concerned. Somebody's just looking for me now and probably trying to get a closer directions into the sighting, so I'm just going to try and help them. Go ahead. Yeah, head towards that pump house. We're close to the pump house, just east of Arethusa Dam. I've got your audio. Okay, copy. That sounds like Sips from Sibambili, who I actually worked with many years ago in the Kruger National Park at another lodge. A wonderful guy, extremely funny. I remember we got some guiding uniform, which is often fairly terrible, and then the guides never like it. They prefer getting their own gear. And we had the most ridiculous shorts ever made. And they didn't have a regular kind of easy access that you can slide your hand into. And you had to almost put your hands in your back pocket to get to the front pocket. And he came up with some wonderful fashionista terminology in an email to our head ranger that I'll never forget. A complete character, and he still says every time he sees me that the shorts are quite side pocketed. So maybe we'll bring that up with him again if he arrives. And interesting how the guides move in the industry. It's a very, very small industry, as big as it is in some regards. You tend to know everyone around, and one person knows the next person, and everything's kind of interlinked. So it's wonderful how you keep friends. And just last night, William, one of the trackers here at Djuma, handed his phone to me, and he said, "It's Frank and Glovo," and that was a another tracker who trained to become a guide on the same guiding course that I did in the Southern Sabi Sands. Haven't spoken to him for a couple of years, and next thing you know, you're getting handed a phone from a guy that you're currently working with, who's pieced together the puzzle that you all know one another. And it's really, really wonderful. Something that I love about the industry, the relationships that you forge with people that you typically wouldn't necessarily, because you work, sleep and play with people all in these remote locations, tends to mean that you make friends with people that you ordinarily wouldn't. Often in the city, you will leave your job and go home and get to spend time with your family or friends that you desire, but sure, you are forced to make friends with whoever's closest to you. Now, for any of you who may have joined the show more recently, we're not doing a full 3-hour safari this evening. Our battery packs are all shattered. I was up at 3:30 this morning coming to look for this lady, which paid off greatly. But we're only going to be doing a 2-hour broadcast, so we're going to be doing the first 2 hours of the show. The last hour we will be relaxing.